Thank you for joining this Healthy Farms, Healthy Agriculture Community conversation on biosecurity and zoonotic disease prevention. I'm Julie Smith, Research Associate Professor at the University of Vermont. This session is being hosted by the University of Arizona, thanks to Dr. Betsy Green and Ashley Wright, Joanna Cummings at the University of Vermont, and Dr. Susan Kerr, who is now retired from Washington State Extension, are also assisting with this webinar. The meeting recording will be posted within about a week on the Healthy Farms, Healthy Agriculture YouTube channel. Again, I'm Dr. Julie Smith, and I want to take a minute to talk about the project that made this meeting possible. I serve as the project director of a large multi-state, multidisciplinary project called the Animal Disease Biosecurity Coordinated Agricultural Project, which was funded by USDA NIFA. Through this project, we have created the new Healthy Farms, Healthy Agriculture website, 6 online learning modules, a set of hands-on activities, and studied biosecurity from several behavioral perspectives. Recordings of our recent webinar series are available on our Healthy Farms, Healthy Agriculture YouTube channel. And if you want to know more about the overall project activities, especially in terms of the research components, you can visit agbiosecurityproject.org. The central theme of all of the project activities has been exploring and influencing the human side of biosecurity. So when we're talking about biosecurity, there's 3 really important things. How do you convince people that it's important? How do you explain what needs to be done? And then how do you get it done consistently? So you will see that theme reflected in today's webinar. Before introducing today's speakers, I'd like you to get a sense of what the Healthy Farms, Healthy Agriculture website has to offer. Joanna Cummings, who is the communication professional working with the project at the University of Vermont, will take us on a quick tour. Joanna, show us the way to the biosecurity resource page for fairs and expositions.
Hi, everyone. I'm quickly showing you the homepage to the Healthy Farms, Healthy Agriculture website. And again, the URL is healthyagriculture.org. Lots of good information on the site for producers, people who are working with producers about livestock and poultry biosecurity. The site is appropriate for producers across the US. It's not just specific to one region. So please take a look at the information. We've got lots of great stuff on prevent, detect, and responding. We have lots of specific biosecurity information for livestock. And then I'm hovering over the training link in the navigation so you can take a look at our page on livestock and poultry in public settings. So this information is specific to anyone who is either a producer, a farmer who is interested or doing agritourism, hosts exhibits, or as a visitor to any kind of petting zoo or exhibition or fair. So we've got a lot of great information here as well and good links. You can download some really handy guides that will take you through a lot of great information on how to protect yourself and your visitors during farm visits. So please take a look at that. And I also wanted to highlight the recordings of biosecurity webinars that we did just recently in October. And we've got 2 of those on this page. I think you'll find interesting, lots of good information on by our expert presenters on their experiences with animal exhibitions. So please take a look, healthyagriculture.org.
Thank you, Joanna, for leading us right where we want to be as we turn things over to this session's moderator and featured guest. I want to remind all participants that you can enter questions or comments in the Q&A at any time. So it's about time for me to turn the reins over to Dr. Betsy Green. Betsy is an extension specialist, equine extension specialist and professor with the University of Arizona, and played a key role in the development of the Scrub Kit hands-on biosecurity activities for the Healthy Farms, Healthy Agriculture Project. She will be introducing today's guest. Betsy, thanks for moderating this session.
Oh, my pleasure. My pleasure. And we are very happy to have Dr. Jeff Bender with us. He is a veterinarian and is with the School of Public Health and the College of Veterinary Medicine at the University of Minnesota. And he's done some really great stuff, epidemiologist, and a lot. He said one of the things that he said earlier is that he's very excited to be talking about some fun stuff that doesn't include the word COVID. So he's going to talk to us about biosecurity and zoonotic disease prevention, keeping our guests and animals healthy and safe. And so we're talking about fairs, which is where a lot of us used to spend our time. And some of us are hoping and waiting to be spending our time together with animals and the exhibitors, the judges, and the public. So Dr. Bender, if you want to, we'll get us started with what we need to know. That'd be great.
Well, it's a real pleasure to be here. And it's actually exciting to know a little bit about your work. It's there's many intersections with what I do and some of the activities that I have. So it is a real pleasure for me to actually to be part of this. A little bit about myself. As I mentioned, I'm a veterinarian. I'm also an epidemiologist and an infectious disease epidemiologist. And actually, previously, I used to work at the health department. And one of the things that in this particular part of my career that I investigated, unfortunately, was many outbreaks actually associated with petting zoos. And actually, I served on a committee almost 20 years ago now that actually looked at developing guidelines and recommendations for preventing infections when folks come to petting zoos or county fairs, state fairs, et cetera. So I'm a public health practitioner. And then to share my biosecurity badge, if you will, I'm also the hospital epidemiologist for the veterinary teaching hospital. So I'm constantly trying to prevent infections between patients and also to our staff and clients as well. So this is where I focus my time and energy on. So I've been asked to talk about this topic about biosecurity and zoonotic disease risk. As I don't really have a strict agenda. I have like three case studies that I was going to present to you. And so feel free to stop me along the way and be more than willing to do this. Now, one of the challenges, I did have one special request from Betsy that I had to have. There was one disease she wanted me to cover. The other ones, I really had a hard time figuring out. Well, I could talk about so many. So I picked two that actually are recent. And so, just because they're a little bit more fresh in my mind that I talk about. So let's go ahead and start. And this is what I hope that you can walk away with today. One is identify what are some of the major risks to patrons, people that are going to come to a fair, to a petting zoo. Identify risk to the animals. So something for you to think about from the opposite side. And when we talk about COVID, we actually are recognizing that people are giving their disease to animals, to cats in particular, seems to be one of the unfortunate recipients of COVID. Also consider what strategies to reduce that risk. And clearly, this group in particular has already been developing and thinking about biosecurity protocols and developed some seemingly excellent materials to really help support that. And then the other thing I just want to leave you with are some educational efforts that that I've been doing or working on that may be beneficial to you, and you may even have some suggestions for me as well. So that's actually what I hope that you can start with. Because you guys are probably Zoom dead, I'm going to do it a little bit different. I'm going to ask you some questions to start us off with. And that first set of questions I'm going to ask you is, if you can, in the chat box, to identify what you consider big diseases or concerns that you've experienced that you would worry about with patrons that would come to a petting zoo. And The second part of that question, I'll probably hold off for the sake of time, but what three diseases would you be concerned about, in looking at a petting zoo setting or a county fair or a state fair setting? Now, I always have a hard time looking at the chats, and so I might just ask.
Okay, so I can help you with that. They're popping in there already with E. coli, rabies, crypto, salmonella, ringworm, campylobacter, sore mouth, salmonella to the patrons, and more E. coli, salmonella parasites, influenza, West Nile virus. We got a horse person in there. COVID, oh, she's influenza, PRRS, rabies, triple E, influenza type A. We've got lots of people. This is great. I'm Martha. I know, and we got people from Arizona to Washington to Vermont answering. Oh, we got Newcastle.
Fantastic. We've got a highly educated group anyways. They should be teaching me. This is great. Perfect. All right. Good. So one of the contexts to be thinking about is a recent report that just came out of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And what they did, they summarized actually animal contact outbreaks. And so in 2017, there were 59 outbreaks linked to animal contact. That was associated with over 1,500 illnesses. These are humans, over 300 hospitalizations, and three deaths. So, you know, there is some risk, and you know, the risk is actually fairly low when you think about the number of millions of visitors that visit animal settings. Outbreaks were associated with livestock in 25 of those cases, with poultry in 15 of those. And again, this is just an initial summary of some of that surveillance data. I also want to just highlight just occupational risk. So, you know, for those folks that actually work on a farm or live on a farm, there are some risks. And so, and work that we've done here in Minnesota just got published this year. They estimated incidence for zoonotic enteric infections. So those people that said E. coli and salmonella and campylobacter, cryptosporidium. And for those folks that actually get those diseases who live or work on a farm, actually was 8 times higher than those that don't work on those farms. So there's a risk. Oftentimes we say, oh, I was raised on a farm, I don't get sick. You know, but unfortunately, we still do. And some of those oftentimes are children. So just some things to think about. We've all probably seen this or heard this, and maybe even you've done outreach for it. But basically, we know that backyard flocks, chickens have really increased in popularity, especially actually during COVID time. I know when I had to get my chickens, I had to wait a long time because, you know, there was actually a back order for chickens. But clearly the number of outbreaks associated with baby chicks and baby ducks actually has increased, and it continues to increase. In fact, even this year, there was a number of cases attributed to kind of backyard flocks. So salmonella risk in backyard chickens is real. So I just bring that up to kind of say an initial introduction to a couple of case studies that I wanted to present to you. So the two case studies that I was going to present is one, salmonella in exhibition, and the second one is swine influenza in exhibition. The first one actually is because the state, I'll fully disclose, the state fair here in Minnesota contacted me and said, Jeff, we're concerned about potential risk to our patrons. How can we protect them better? I thought they were incredibly proactive in this, and so we discussed a number of strategies, and frankly, he just wanted to know what risk areas, what ways can I improve biosecurity especially during a busy time. And if you're familiar with our state fair, we get nearly 2 million visitors during the state fair. So it's a big deal. But clearly they were interested in looking at flow and decreasing the potential risk to patrons, especially for pathogens like E. coli 157, which causes bloody diarrhea and can cause kidney failure in children, and salmonella. And so they wanted to start a study to look at, before a fair, during the fair, and after the fair, and particularly in the cattle and swine barn. So I'm presenting this because there are some really simple things that really came out and were very intriguing for the state fair organizers, but also, as thinking about the risk. So we wanted to sample, the areas that they were most concerned about. So we sampled the swine in the dairy barns, and we cultured them from salmonella. We also used a tool called a bioluminometer. And often in food safety, we often use a luminometer to say, is that surface clean or not? So this luminometer is a way to kind of look at how clean something is or cleanliness. So just to give you a little background, this luminometer samples were done. The frequency, and cultures were done. We did samples taken before the fair, during the fair, and then after the fair. And just to quickly give you a brief description, I apologize, this is actually my field notes, if you will. But this is the cattle barn, and I'm just going to highlight a couple of sections here. So basically, you've got doors in and out. You've got actually a public area where people can actually see the milking cows. They can try to get some information about people to the public to understand dairy animals alone and how milk is processed and pasteurized. But then basically these are all the stalls where cattle are. There are wash racks for the 4-H and FFAers to actually clean their animals beforehand. And also there's an outside area where they can actually wash as well. And so the animals, especially these dairy cows, would be coming up these aisles and then into the milking parlor and then brought back. And so the public can actually walk throughout this whole area during this time of the fair. And so the fair organizers were concerned and says, should we allow that? Just because the public oftentimes aren't exposed to these particular agents, particular organisms, and can be of concern. Similarly, when you look at the swine barn, there's an entrance area here. There's an area where they display the biggest pigs, usually a sow with piglets. And basically the general public can see these. And basically you can see the stalls that would have the pigs. And then here's the show ring. And so again, the people can actually wander all around here. There are cleaning areas in the corners for washing down pigs. And so this is a typical, in a sense, a barn that would be at a state fair where the public would potentially interact. So before the fair, we sampled and there was no salmonella found. So that's a good thing. It was a testament to their cleaning ability and their what they've done. The luminometer, the cleanliness factor, we looked at, and it ranged from 138 to 25,000. Ideally, you want less than 1,000 in this kind of environment. In a food environment, you want less than 100. You want it really clean. But this is a barn. So we looked around and we were just trying to see. So this is again before the fair. Now during the fair, some interesting things were noted. So I show you this picture, this graph to show you that these are the different areas that we sampled. So, it includes anything from, we actually walked an alley and we actually put little booties on our feet and walked it, or we went outside to look at the wash rack and a number of just what we call drag swabs across the areas there. This is the percent positive in the cattle barn. You can see that the number of salmonellas was actually quite high in a number of the areas. So this is actually 50% right here. 50% of the samples were positive. So needless to say that salmonella is there. And
Jeff, quick question on that. So where you have the center alley drag, is that what you showed where people walk through from one end of the barn to the other?
Yeah, that is it. Yep. So yep, that's the right down the middle where people will walk right through. So probably most people are not going to go by the drain wash, but the cross alleys all would be positive. So you can just easily see that people go through with their strollers or walk through are actually walking in areas where they're going to pick up salmonella. So this is what the organizers were concerned about. And these numbers were a little bit disturbing when we shared it with them when we got the culture results. The other thing that we wanted to do is that not all salmonellas are the same. In fact, there are 25 different different salmonella serotypes. And so that actually represents that means that they're probably different animals if they're different serotypes. Even though some animals might have multiple serotypes that they might shed. But so the other thing we wanted to look at is what kind of salmonella did we see? And so this actually is the number of different serotypes in the different settings. And so here's this central alleyway. There were four different serotypes. So this means that when animals are coming into a state fair type setting, that often they're coming from multiple different farms. And this is evidenced by the fact that we have four different serotypes. So most likely it was four different farms or four different animals as a possibility. That we just wanted to show that as a potential risk. So when we did this on the swine side, again, there was a number of positives. I was actually thinking the swine would be higher than the dairy cattle. But 50% of samples in some places were quite high. So 50% in the center alley for the pig area, the cross alleys. And then basically this is the swine area around, or the swine that were around the public area. So this is where the largest boar was. And this is where most people would congregate. There are different serotypes. So we wanted to take a look. And again, you could see that there were a number of different serotypes that were found in these different areas, probably representing different animals that were coming in. To kind of summarize this a little bit, I actually broke it down for you by date. So this is during the fair. So these are basically each day during the fair that we sampled, the percent positive for that day, the number of different serotypes, and then one of the things that we try to do is break it down by group. So these might be an open class, this might be the 4-H class, and this might be, another class. So basically representing that it didn't really matter that, which class it was, but that they did have a number of positive salmonellas there. So basically say that, these kind of settings can be risky, especially for urban folks who never been on a farm and, that might, want to have their kids with them. And so it is a potential risk. And that's why, biosecurity and cleanliness are really important. The last slide I want to do before I just kind of do a summary of this is the luminometer findings. So again, we shoot for about 1,000 or less than 1,000. And you can see that basically most of these are over 1,000. What's interesting is that the bathroom was one of the cleanest one, and that probably reflects the fact that it gets cleaned. These other places, the handrails and other things don't get cleaned and have a lot of hand contact. So it represents the fact that, people are putting their hands on it to look over. Maybe they don't wash their hands, they put their hands to their face. Just goes to show you some of the potential risks that might occur in
that's,
those.
That's pretty scary.
It again disturbed the organizers a little bit, and actually they created some plans for that. And actually that's gonna be one of my questions for you. So just in summary, before I ask my questions of you, is salmonella was frequently found. There was a number of diverse types of salmonellas were found, suggesting new and different sources were being brought in. And we also had high bioluminometer values, suggesting frequent hand contact and contamination there. So my next question for you, based on what I just presented, is with this information, what would you suggest, now that you've had all this biosecurity training, for cleaning, for frequency of cleaning, for traffic flow, for others? So if you wouldn't mind, just you don't have to answer all four of those, but based on what you heard, what would you suggest that this fair organizer do? So I'd be real curious to see your responses. So if you could put that in the chat box for me, that'd be great.
Okay, so Dr. Bender, while they start blowing up our chat with information answers, did they randomly survey hands of any of the public or participants as they passed through the barn area?
We did not. We talked about that, but we did not. And I'd venture to guess that there'd be some pretty high values on those folks. So what are they bringing in? And actually, you need to save that one for the next case study.
Okay, hold that thought. All right, so we have, let's see, clean the surfaces and handrails, lots of sign washing about hand washing, or signage about hand washing. We can wash the signs too. Limit the travel of public through the aisles, but that's the fun part. That's what everyone goes to the fair for, so they can put their strollers down that center aisle, wash down the area after demonstrations, hand sanitizer stations, frequency of cleaning, make sure they're not cross-contaminating, hand washing stations at exits, traffic flow, separate lanes for animal versus people, foot washes. How effective are foot washes? And I know that answer is it depends, but can you maybe give us some thoughts on that?
Sure. So you really brought up some really ideas, and these are some of the very same ideas that we did talk about. So thanks so much for putting your comments in the chat box there. I'm looking at them now as we go through. So yeah, so one of the things they try to do is talk to their staff about, okay, maybe we do need to wipe handrails at the end of the day. Then the question to me is, how frequently should we do this? What should we use to do this? So getting into, you know, what is an appropriate disinfectant? How frequently should we clean these surfaces? So yeah, you're right. Signage was another one. They actually already had signage, but it was difficult because it's a big barn and it's hard to actually get those. So thinking about, well, what is signage that actually works? Now, I'm going to make a sexist remark here, and bear with me, is that women read signs, men don't read signs. So one of the things is how do we get to be better sign makers to meet to different audiences there? So that was another issue that we had to raise. The other issue is hand sanitizing stations. How do we actually get people to see them? And I like that somebody put in here, yeah, you need to put those hand washing stations at the entrance and exit. And actually, that's one of the things that the fair organizers did is they basically built the hand sinks right in the entrance and exit. So people actually had to stumble over that when they left. And there was a big sign that says, hey, you need to wash your hands on your way out. So those were some of the things that they really did. The one area that they really struggled with was flow, is how do you do flow through that? And so they've struggled. And I think it was last year, would be the year before since we couldn't do the fair this year. They did try some flow dynamics to limit where people would actually go. And then they also tried to more frequently change the sawdust that they put down the center alley as a way to remove fecal material or actually encourage that as well. But those are examples of just some concerns and biosecurity concerns that they had there. So you also, Betsy, raised the question about foot baths. So foot baths would be absolutely disastrous at a state fair. The reason being is that basically, you know, when you've got as many people as going through, that foot bath would be useless probably in 5 minutes. Because of all the organic material that would actually walk through that and inactivate it. So foot baths are actually good for biosecurity if you've got limited people going through and You've got the right type of material and you've got a mechanism to make sure that the boots get cleaned. So one of the issues that I have in my hospital is people wear these deep furrowed boots that get a bunch of manure, but they never wash their, they don't scrub it. They don't wash it off with a brush. And then also the other thing that a lot of our students do is that they toe dip. They don't really put their foot in the foot bath. So usually a hydrogen peroxide type of a product works pretty good in a foot bath. It's a great biosecurity measure, especially for production facilities. So the poultry operation, the swine operation, et cetera. But in this kind of setting, it's probably not going to be helpful.
Well, somebody also mentioned flip-flops. A lot of people wearing flip-flops at the fair too.
Yeah, especially at a fair, it just wouldn't work. The other thing that somebody brought up is an excellent point is the immunocompromised person and signage for them, especially for the folks that you know might be immunocompromised, that they want to take some precautions, but also the fact that strollers, we've had outbreaks associated with people going through with strollers, going with their footwear, going home, taking them off, and then subsequently probably, you know, touching their strollers or touching their feet or shoes and subsequently getting sick. So we've had situations where we've been able to document some concerns there as well. All right. Well, I'm going to move to the second case study. And which is about influenza. So probably my most notorious research project was I was sampling influenza in 2008 and 2009 at the state fair. We were just starting to talk about the risk of influenza from pigs to people. And so we were curious about this. Well, if you remember back in 2009, we had a pandemic, a different pandemic. And that pandemic was an influenza pandemic. And I, unfortunately, was the person that found the first case of the pandemic strain in pigs. And unfortunately, it really hit our swine industry bad. They may not have ever forgiven me for that. It was an innocent project. We just happened to be sampling pigs, and unfortunately, somebody gave a pig an influenza strain, and it was quite a dramatic. But needless to say, that this has been an interesting topic to explore, just to look at the potential for zoonotic issues and pigs, because pigs are often been associated with influenza. And at the time I was actually working closely with my colleagues from the National Pork Board and other things, because they were curious to know about this issue as well, but this was before the pandemic. So if you look at influenza, we have really learned a lot about how it behaves. Our traditional model has been this model. We believe that aquatic ducks really are the reservoir and they give it to other animals. They might give it to horses, they might give it to dogs, they might give it to humans, they might give it to pigs. Now, the dog issue is, fairly new. So we've actually learned a lot over the last 10, 15 years in this. But also there are other ways that we are probably giving influenza. We now understand that people give influenza to pigs, as well as to ducks, and it can be reassorted. This is often termed the mixing vessel to other humans. But the other issue that is that people are giving these to pigs, and then pigs can sometimes redo this to then also give it to other people as well. So these are some of the issues that we are seeing and have a better understanding of in looking at influenza in pigs. So in particular, We've seen some issue with swine exhibition and also live animal markets. So I'm not sure if in your neck of the woods, if you have live animal markets, but some cultures prefer to be able to pick out their animal and say, we want this chicken, we want this pig, and you know, you can slaughter it right here. So, and also when you think about exhibition areas, they're really kind of a unique opportunity for people to interact with animals that they just don't see. And it is a wonderful training ground, especially for our kids. And the question is what precautions should we be taking in this regard? So to highlight this issue, actually since 2009, we received additional funding to look at some of these issues, but I wanna highlight just the outbreaks that occurred. In 2012, there was a fairly significant outbreak in the Midwest with over 300 confirmed cases from 12 states, 16 hospitalizations. 11 of the 16 were individuals at high risk for complications, and then there was one death associated with this. This was strongly associated with exhibiting pigs at state and county fairs. Most of these individuals had been either showing those animals, so a lot of these were kids, or they may have just walked through or been in the barns with those animals. So one of the studies that actually sponsored with folks at Ohio State is, so again, they fortuitously did what I did. They were just gonna say, okay, we're gonna sample pigs, and look for influenza. They didn't know that all of a sudden there was gonna be human cases though. And so this is what happened is they went to a number of fairs in Ohio. So, and then basically this is, did these pigs have influenza-like illness? Yes or no. The number of pigs that they tested, the number that actually were positive by PCR. So was there genetic sequences there or not? How many they actually were able to isolate by virus isolation? So could they get and grow the virus? And then the different types that were found. And so sure enough, they grew this particular type called H3N2. So the different H and N types refer to kind of the mechanism of attachment and replication that occurs in the body of the animal. And unfortunately, during this time, there were actually a number of these county fairs that actually had human cases. And so these were actually kind of after the fact, they were sampling during the fair, and then they heard, oh my gosh, there's people that were sick. And so then the health department, the CDC instantly said, what results do you have and do they match up? And so sure enough, they did match up. And so most likely these human cases actually got it from the pigs. So it raises a number of questions about kind of biosecurity and protocols. And so there were a number of comments or recommendations that came out. Do you allow contact with pigs? What should our recommendations be to the public? Should we vaccinate the pigs? Should we have vaccine for the exhibitors? How long do you exhibit these pigs? What are some screening protocols? Are there ways to look for pigs? Can we take their temperatures on the way in? Are there ways to screen for just influenza-like illness? Should we test all the pigs before they come in was one of the questions. Should we just encourage good hand washing? Is this something that we can just really deal with from a standpoint of hand washing? So this raised a number of questions and really not a lot of answers. And so we pulled together, and I say the collective we, I actually was part of this group, to actually sit and say, okay, what collaborative actions can we take to try to protect the public? So this is actually through measures to minimize influenza transmission in swine exhibitions. This has been updated now for, I think every 2 years now it gets updated. And it's done by the National Association of State Public Health Veterinarians, as well as National Assembly of State Animal Health Officials. And basically deals with how do we educate folks about this? How do we design venues? What is the role of the fair veterinarian? And then also just really bringing in a number of the stakeholders who are who are part of this process. So, and needless to say, it's a very complex issue, and I do have some questions for you about this. But before I do, I just want to just try to provide a balanced view on influenza. We now know that humans transmit far more influenza than pigs do, and that pigs are often the unfortunate recipients of human infections. So human to swine transmission is really key to that evolution of influenza diversity. So we called it swine influenza in 2009, but actually it probably should have been called a human influenza, because in 2009, the markets were closed. It was a bad thing. It was tough on our swine producers at that time. And also humans really do sow the seeds of future pandemics by infecting pigs. And so one of the things that many swine producers now do is try to really strongly encourage that folks get their seasonal influenza vaccine that work in swine operations and provide a mechanism for that. We've also developed a video for workers, that they can actually give flu to pigs and that they want to be able to protect themselves, their workers, the pigs as well. So that's one thing. If you're responsible for swine animal exhibitions, such as the swine swine exhibitions, what would you need what would you recommend, and who would you need to involve, and how would you educate your staff and public? One is that we want to encourage folks to have a better understanding and appreciation for farming and agriculture and that interaction. But yeah, those are some of the same points that are brought up. No jackpot shows was one of the big issues, as we get pigs to circulate around. And so there are some recommendations that came out. One is to shorten the period of time that the pigs are there, because the pigs can amplify the virus and actually spread it, especially if the show is for, longer. So generally they try to shorten it to 3 days that those pigs are there, and then they have to go away. Also, it gets back to basic biosecurity. When those pigs go home, if they go home, they got to be separated or they have to go to slaughter. So those are some other things for you to think about. Terminal shows only. Yeah, exactly. So you guys are really a wonderful group and you're thinking about these things already. So really appreciate your comments on that. So the next thing I just want to have you think about is that there are some checklists for things to do that you can minimize. So that's available actually in the slides that we provided, and you can take a look at that. There are things you can do before and during the exhibition, things to do if there is an outbreak, and measures to take after the exhibition as well. And this gets into what I call the hierarchy of controls. There are ways that we can actually try to really eliminate disease or improve biosecurity. One is just to remove that, and prevent that pathogen. Can we engineer that conditions to really, put hand sinks in certain places? Are there certain policies that we can do to actually encourage us? You talk about no jackpot shows as a possibility, or other administrative controls that we can have. Are there personal protective equipment things that we can do? This might get down to hand washing and other things that they can have. There are some information. We've done some work through our center called UMass, the Upper Midwest Agricultural Safety and Health Center, on agritourism and protecting folks. Part of that is thinking about layout and design. How do people move through, and how to make sure that they wash their hands when they leave? Some of our 4-H folks have done just amazing work on just hand washing and hand washing materials. We've actually redesigned these to reflect our COVID issues. And so those information is available on the outreach and education materials that we've got. So in summary, one is for us to be aware of the risks to our staff and our patrons and our guests, to really consider the risks to the animals and measures to control disease. We need to identify those strategies to reduce the risk through cleaning, through isolation, early notification, and really to engage staff as part of that educational outreach. So that's, and it sounds like that's exactly what you folks are doing, and I really want to say, hey, I really appreciate this. I really appreciate the efforts that the NEPA-funded work has done, and appreciate your continued efforts in really working on biosecurity. So my hat's off, my applause to your efforts. So with that, I'm gonna stop here and allow for any questions or comments, corrections, because I'll let you know I'm not perfect, but be glad to entertain any comments or suggestions or questions.
Oh, you can't miss my one, my case study. Okay, so got a question. Would airflow help out?
The answer is yes. And actually, that was another issue that came up with our state fair colleagues, especially in the swine barn. Could airflow help minimize or reduce some of the risk? And the answer is yes. And so they actually did improve the air exchanges in that building and really allowed for that, especially for influenza. Most likely that's actually, you know, sneezing pigs, coughing pigs, you know, probably are putting that into a droplet form in there. So yeah, could we reduce that? Is one thing that's important. Again, most of the risks to humans, though, are going to be those enteric zoonotic pathogens. So hand washing and keeping things out of people's mouths are probably the big issue.
So Dr. Bender, we do have a several of my equine science students on here. So do me a 2-minute mystery on the last case that you have there.
Okay. All right. So bear with me here. So I have one extra case study because I didn't know time-wise how things would go. But here is a situation where you have a 4-H family member contacts you that one of their children is complaining about fever, headache, muscle aches, and feeling tired. And one of their horses is feeling pretty sick. And if you look at that poor horse there, that horse is not feeling really well, really, really well. So the question is, could the child have picked up something from the horse? And what do you think that might be? And then what precautions would you recommend? So any brave souls out there to venture a guess?
Go for it. We haven't covered this in class yet, but oh, sending the child to a terminal market, Susan? Wait a minute. Okay, there we go. Yeah, we got salmonella, we got VS. Ding, ding, ding.
Yeah, so actually one of the more common things that we were always worried about in horse shows in particular is actually salmonella shedding. And so, you know, that's very obvious. Influenza, fortunately, we don't see transmission of equine influenza strains to humans, which is good, which is great. But VS is actually quite a big deal this year, especially, you know, in the Southwest. Caustic material, actually, that's a good one when you look at that tongue. So that's a great guess. So this is actually vesicular stomatitis that I just present here. This is a reportable disease, as you may or may not know. It is a viral disease of horses, cattle, and pigs. Usually the animals, we get fever and kind of mucosal vesicles that rupture and coalesce into very large lesions. And actually it's a differential for a disease that we're always concerned about, foot and mouth disease, especially in cattle and pigs. It is spread by really direct contact or by insect vectors. Probably the human case is going to be by direct contact. And it really is endemic throughout the Southwest. And, you know, affected and suspect horses will be quarantined, and interstate movement and trade will be affected as a result of this. So I just bring this up because this has been a big issue this year, you know, with the number of cases throughout, you know, basically Oklahoma, Missouri, Kansas, as well as in New Mexico and Arizona. the epidemic curve, if you will, the number of cases over time, actually peaked right around the summer months and actually, you know, haven't had any further cases since basically late September that have been reported. And the current situation was that there were over 300 vesicular stomatitis cases, affected premises that were identified. 206 of these were actually confirmed positive and 120 were suspect. Most of these were actually equine only operations. And then current time that there's no active quarantines in place at this point. So this outbreak seems to be over, but I just bring this up as a situation or case for the situation highlights the importance of good biosecurity, good recognition of diseases, early reporting and engagement of a veterinarian to identify, and then basically really working with folks on how do we prevent the spread of that.
Thanks, Betsy. This has been a really great exchange of information, and we don't want the conversation to end here. So we're going to take you on a quick tour over to where we have a Healthy Farms biosecurity subgroup on Connect Extension. So we have some forums in the Connect Extension environment where we can continue to exchange questions and experiences about a variety of biosecurity topics. You'll see that we've already started forums related to previous community conversations that we held on mortality composting, protecting plant and animal health, a new twist on One Health, and youth biosecurity education. And we have, as I mentioned earlier, a number of materials on our website about biosecurity education. So we'll be setting up a new topic for discussion on keeping animals and people healthy and safe at events where they come together based on today's webinar. As I said, the forums are hosted by Connect Extension. It's really easy to register for an account there. If you haven't already, you go to connect.extension.org, then join a subgroup. To find the biosecurity community subgroup, you can use the site search feature and search for Healthy Farms, and the Healthy Farms biosecurity community subgroup will come up. And once they're there, you can create or respond to topics. And you'll also want to make sure that once you've joined, you have a profile and you'll want to adjust your profile settings, your notification settings from within your profile. Which gives you control over how many notifications you get from the Connect Extension system. So this concludes today's Healthy Farms, Healthy Agriculture Community Conversation. Be well and biosecure.